Hello YouTube, my name is Andrew. This is my first video on my channel I'll be putting up. Just random thoughts I like to have every day. Some will be good, some will be bad. You know, who knows? But right now, just to get kind of used to the format, the video, camera, my mic, I'm going to go over something that I really enjoy and hopefully it'll make some sense. So I'm pretty much a gamer at heart, but I've been an avid reader all my life, and the very first thing I wanted to do was put a review of my favorite book, Armor by John Steakley. Steakley was a Texas boy, much like I am, born and raised, and he passed away not too long ago. This was my favorite book growing up, mostly because of the visuals it gave you and it puts you inside the main character, his head. But the images were so visceral and the action was so good. And the story, I've heard many people say you either love it or you don't understand it or you hate it. There's really no in between of those three. So I'm going to give my synopsis, and hopefully it'll be under an hour of this book because there's a lot that goes into it. So, first thing, you can see by the cover, you know, you got basic space marine looking guy, so you can think, okay, it's sci-fi, it's a future, there's going to be battles and guns. And that's what I thought whenever my dad first gave me this book. The thing is, though, there's a lot more undertones to it than that. It does start off with your main character, you know, he's just called Felix. There's basically just about three chapter titles in the entire book, and the first one is Felix, you know, the main character. It basically talks about him right before a drop, is what they call these missions. And it's a future, you know, it's sci-fi, so they're going to be teleported down in his big-ass room on his big-ass spaceship. He likes to use descriptive words of the whole fleet that he's involved in as just massive. Like, everything about this fleet is massive. It's based out of Earth. It's a human colony. Not a colony. It's a human empire, I guess you could call it, going out from Earth. And then basically they're going to war against this race of aliens they call... It's some sci-fi name, but they just all call them ants because they're all, you know, about 7.5, 8 feet tall. You know, got pinchers, got the little mandibles, got thoraxes. So they call them ants. So the very beginning of the book is him preparing to go down and attack these ants with another group they call B Squad, for lack of a better term. So there's going to be A, B, and C. Like, okay, you're going to go attack, you know, this huge emplacement, and we're going to go kick ass because we have power armor. And that's another thing they really harp on in this book is the power armor is supposed to be this massive thing. It's not form-fitting, so it's about a foot and a half taller than what you are, so you kind of get into it like an exosuit almost, but it's close to what human proportion should be. So it's him before the drop. He's just kind of making the rounds. You know, he's a loner. You're inside his head, and he's not very impressed. He's volunteered, you find out, to do this, and the first thing reason why he's not impressed is because they made him a scout. Apparently, scouts are the lowest rung of the totem pole when it comes to pretty much everything when it comes to power armor. They have less power, they have less armaments, they don't have inputting like energy blast, which is called blaze capacity. So he's pissed off already that they made him a scout. So he's faster. He's about twice as fast as any normal warrior pseudo armor, but he basically just has an attached rifle that is a blaze rifle that has a limited charge that you have to recharge, and then he has like maybe 10 blaze bombs. And he compares it to the warrior suit, has like input blaze capacity where you just do the Spider-Man thing, you know, put the arm down and then comes out there and you just blazed out everything in front of you, and you have like, you know, 30 bombs or something along those lines of just, it's a more of a tank that you're in if you're a warrior suit. So he starts doing the rounds. You know, it's the night before the drop. It's their very first action on this planet. So they're like, hey, whatever they did to Earth, they're pissed off. They're going to go attack them, and then they're going to go kick their ass. He starts doubting a lot before the drop. Like, he's just thinking to himself, Oliver, we're not ready. Like, everyone here, you know, they think they're going to go down and kick ass, but we've had 6 months worth of training from boot to training with power armor, and now we're all here. So he's already starting to think, this may not be the best thing, but damn it, I'm here. I'm going to do my best. So he goes around before the drop, and he, you know, people try to engage him, but he's kind of staying off. He just kind of gives them one-word answers. You know, doesn't really want to make friends, you know. And his backstory is kind of vague at this point. You don't really know what he's going to be doing or what he has done. So he goes in and, you know, basically stays up, passes out somewhere, you know, and they wake him up the next day and like, hey, got to get ready to drop. And like, well, everyone else was partying the night before, so fuck it. He goes in, gets some breakfast, and then he goes to the briefing. So everyone gets, you know, in their suits, everyone lines up for their briefing, and the guy that's doing the briefing is a complete fucking noob. You can tell he's never led men into battle. He's just basically reading off a script, and Felix notices this. He picks up on this. So, you know, they say the plan, okay, here's the fort. A squad's going to be here. B squad's going to be here. C squad, the bulk of the force, is going to be here. They're going to go up to the fort, attack it, and then A and B squads will put you by these supply dumps over here, and nothing should happen. You'll all be bored until you get picked up or transported back, like, in 24 hours later. So he's in B squad. He's like, eh, whatever. You know, we're going to war. We shouldn't have anything to do, but, you know, what the hell. So finally, the reason he gets pissed off at this guy is after he lays out the plan, he starts giving them a pep talk. And he realizes immediately he doesn't believe in the plan. So he's trying to get them to believe in him instead to get psyched up. Like, oh, we can do this. We're ready. And Felix is having none of it. So the reason I like this imagery is because John Stakely puts you in his mind of, wait a minute. This isn't, you know, the quintessential, oh, rah-rah, you know, story of we're going to, you know, this is the hero, he's going to overcome all odds and everything will be all right because we're on the side of right and, you know, we're killing the bad aliens and whatever. And he's just like, wait a minute, this is fucking bullshit. this isn't right. This isn't good. This is kind of thrown together and now they're throwing us at this enemy expecting us to conquer just because we're right, because it's manifest destiny, because I don't know, because they say we were attacked and now we're retaliating. You know, they never really go into the whole backstory of what they did to them, but they basically say one thing, that the ants attacked Earth and now they're going to kick their asses. So finally, the drop starts. They describe it as you're in the largest room in space, in the largest ship in space. Just imagine a huge hangar where there's nothing but a wall in front of you that they call a transit. So you're supposed to run up the wall. Everyone's supposed to, you know, try to plow through it. And then at the last second, they'll teleport everyone to where they're supposed to be instantaneously. So Felix is like, all right, better get ready for the jump. But he's just getting madder and madder. He's like, what the hell is up with this? You know, fuck this guy. Fuck this planet. You know, I'm not even from Earth. Why the hell am I doing this? This is bullshit. You know, I'm mad at everything. And then the anger just keeps going up. And then all of a sudden, a switch flips in his brain. And he's just like, fuck it. And he's on mission. He's on point. And they're about to transit everyone. So he's like, all right. Get my freaking, you know, blaze rifle out, and which is against regulations, apparently. You're not supposed to have it out before you transit. But it's almost time to go, so he starts running at the wall. No one else is moving because they're all still in disbelief that they're actually doing this. They're not ready. They know it. And he's the only one doing what he's trained to do. He's about to hit the damn wall. And finally, they transit everyone. And, you know, he goes to his, they transit his whole squad, the B squad, to the supply dump. And the next thing he writes is just an image in your mind of, oh my God, fucking ants! Ants everywhere! You know, he's shooting, throwing bombs. He's like, oh my God, shit! You know, blam, blam, blam. You know, just pinchers everywhere. There's, you know, a whole fucking row of them. And then they don't end. He just keeps on plowing forward, shooting, shooting. You know, his shooting so much within the first 30 seconds that his blaze rifle is overheating already. So, which is not supposed to happen for hours after battle. He's using it so much just from dropping in the next 30 seconds. And finally, after fighting for what seems like an eternity, he blows through the last line of ants and starts running. He's like, what the? You know, he's just thinking, all right, got to get some distance. You know, he's in full combat mode at this point. So he's just analyzing, going up, you know, dunes, and it's all sand. This is a barren planet. It's all, the oceans are acid. There's like 800 different, you know, types of sand, kind of like they liken it to how the Inuit have 30 different words for snow. That's about what this planet is like with sand. So it's a barren wasteland. You can hardly see for, you know, a couple miles around because there's dust storms. And he goes over a dune, turns around, you know, and then stops and like, all right, are they after me? Am I being followed? So he kind of turns around and he sees an ant come over the hill. So he's like, all right, you know, they're coming over. I'll kill that one. All right, that one's down. And then two come over. All right, kill that one. Down, then they start coming over more frequently. He's like, okay, maybe I won't stay here. Maybe I'll, you know, throw a bomb, one of my bombs I have left, and then kind of get a better angle at it. So he throws a bomb, leaps away, and these power armor, pretty much what you expect from Halo. You can jump, you know, four times as high as a normal person, run, you know, eight times as fast. You're basically the, you know, the quintessential space marine almost, except more mobile, especially with the scout suit, which he has, which is faster. So he does this. He goes around, gets a better view. He looks back to where he landed, and there are rows and rows and rows of almost looks like thousands upon thousands of ants. And he dropped maybe 200 warriors, and he's a one scout in his squad. So he looks back, and there's just nothing but beams going off, you know, explosions, and what he calls the foomph, you know, the basically whenever a suit loses integrity and your base, everything just kind of goes outward from the exit wound, and you're basically dead. Once your suit loses integrity, that's it. You know, it's pretty much like almost like a vacuum there. So he looks at it like, nothing you can do back there. You know, they're fucked. Unless anyone does what I did and gets out, there's no saving those people. So he hears, you know, the radio, everyone screaming, dying. And he just like, well, I better go rendezvous with the other squads. So he starts trekking out. It's very vague at this point, what he writes about. Basically, he's running and fighting for hours, trying to get to the rendezvous point with the other squads. And he says, He gives a couple of anecdotes of how I almost got trapped in quicksand. They almost got him another time whenever one sand he thought was solid just went straight through. Like it's a barren wasteland. It's hell. It's hell, basically. He can't get anywhere. He can't do anything. He's just fighting to survive at this point. So he finally starts hearing some chatter and goes down to where Squad A is, the other squad that has only 200 people, you know, and one scout. And he sees they're all dead. There's about three ants that are, you know, going around the battlefield, just kind of sashaying around, not really doing anything. Ants don't have intelligence. They're kind of like drones from what they understand. So they're just, the only thing to know is that if you're on your planet and it's not you, you die. So they're making sure everyone's dead or nothing's moving, and then they move off, and Felix needs power. His suit is drained. You know, he's on like, you know, 15% power. Once it gets down to like 10%, you start slowing down. Once it gets down to 5%, you stop. And then once it gets down to zero, the, you know, little plant they have that generates oxygen stops working and you die anyway. But before that, the ants are going to get you, because if you can't move, you can't fight. If you can't fight, there's nothing else you can do. Like, his weapon's busted. He's been using it as a club after the charge ran out. You know, he's been using his fist to punch through, you know, thoraxes, membranes, you know, brain casings, eyeballs, anything, just to stay alive. So the suits are pretty sturdy. From what I understand, they call it plasteel, but it's not indestructible. And from what they say, the ants are insanely strong, and if they get a hold of you, they can eventually tear, you know, a hole in your suit. And every once in a while, they'll have like a, let's just call it a laser blaster, where they have to have it on for about 30 seconds on one spot on your armor to have it actually have a hole through it. So it's not like, you know, they're advanced, but they do have what their version of technology, and they have massive size and strength just from genetics. So he's finally going down to this barren wasteland, the slaughter of their other squad. And the way you can get energy is you can make a connection at the hip with another suit, and as long as it still has its integrity for the most part, you can get some power out of it. So he goes up to a couple, you know, like, okay, dead, makes connection, you know, and you're face to face with these people when you're doing it. So he's just trying to distance himself, like, okay, just going to do what I have to do. And then he gets to one and makes connection and looking at the faceplate, and the person starts screaming. And he immediately pukes. He's like, fuck! He's like, shut the hell up. You're going to get him honest. And he, you know, works some panels on her arm. It's a female warrior. This is a co-ed army. And, you know, gives her a trank, calms her down. And, you know, she's like, hey, you know, what... How am I looking? He's like, your back's broken. You can't move your legs. And she's like, well, you know, just get out of here. Leave me. You know, I'm done for anyway. And he's like, shut up. He's like, no, don't be brave. You know, go ahead. Get out of here. He's like, shut the fuck up. There are ants coming this way. And there's two ants coming that way. And, you know, for whatever reason, they look like they're about to walk on by. Because, like I said, they're basically laying on top of each other like this, making connection, trying to get power. And then all of a sudden, they're on them. For whatever reason, they know they're still alive. And, you know, one's got a laser, and he's pointing at Felix, and Felix is trying to fight him off, and it keeps missing. Finally, he kills the two ants, and he realizes why they're missing, because they were basically killing her through her faceplate with the laser. So the ants don't care about anything but making you dead, apparently. So as he realizes it, he's like, okay, now she's dead. There are no more survivors. He gets up to about 80% power from all the other bodies around. He doesn't get attacked anymore. And he finally is like, okay, well, C Group, they had like 5,000 warriors. So they can't, they have to be alive. They're like, if they did the same thing to our group that they did to their group for A and B, then yeah, those guys are fucked, because they dropped them in the middle of rows of these ants. And what he found out was that the supply dumps were just basically hives. They were just little bunkers for ants that are just come out the entrance to the underground in rows of waves. So he's pissed off, like I said, because he knows that they were fucked from the beginning. But he expected it. So that's why he went in guns blazing instead of just like a lamb to slaughter. So finally, a couple hours later, he's down to like, you know, 60%. He's still pretty good on power. And he starts hearing chatter for the first time on the radio. And the first thing he hears is like, fuck this shit. I don't even like Earth. And he sees some deserters leaving. And he's like, where are y'all going? And like, we're out. We're not going to fight anymore. He's like, don't stop us. He's like, okay. He's like, we're going. And he just asks him, where? And they're like, they don't answer, but you can see that they're, you know, they're kind of thinking about, like, that's a good question. But they're like, they're gone. They're deserting. They're done. He's like, this is Banshee. Where are you going? This planet is Banshee. There's nowhere to go. So finally, he gets some good radio chatter. Group C, you know, he gets some battle chatter. And they're like, oh, the beacon's here. You know, that's going to transport us back to the ship. And he goes toward it, and then you know, someone grabs him, like, what are you doing? He's like, I'm going to the beacon. He's like, if you want a dessert, fine. He's like, no, get the fuck away from there. He's like, why? And then an explosion just lights up the entire freaking place. And she, after they pick themselves up, after the, another couple of explosions, they explain, what the fuck was that? I was like, where have you been? I'm like, B-Squad? It's like, where's everyone else? I'm it. Oh, shit. So this is the only other scout that he's seen so far that's survived. And apparently she's the only one that's still survived from the largest group of 5,000 warriors. So she explains to him, okay, the beacons are fucked. We've lost contact with the ship. Every time the beacons go, they're automated. They just have satellites just, you know, putting them down every couple hours, you know, for anyone who is trying to get home, get back. So we don't know where what's happening up there. We think it was hit. This ship was hit. The beacon, every time it goes off, somehow they home in on it with missiles or whatever the fuck they use for missiles and just annihilate the area. So we can't use those to get home. We can't contact the ship. We don't know what's going on. The next retrieval is not for another day and a half for our rescue now. Because apparently, whenever the group of 5,000 landed, everything was fine. They went to the fort, made a good, you know, battle line. They had about 2,000 ants come at them. They were good. Then they had about 10,000 ants come at them a couple more times. They're just mowing them down. And after 5,000 warriors, you know, blazing shit and throwing grenades, you know, and then using these big-ass emplacements that they put down too. You know, they're having a good time just killing ants. But then she says, yeah, after about 10 hours of this, everyone kind of stops and looks around. I was like, there's way too many ants here. There's like at least 150,000 we've killed in the last 10 hours, and they're not stopping. They keep coming every hour or so. So the command gets worried. They've lost contact with the ship. And then all of a sudden, she tells them, they realize those are just scouting parties. So the first major wave comes, and they almost buckle right then. They almost all die. And then the line holds, and then at the very last minute, everyone throws a bomb, and it just obliterates the area, and they survive. Then they move because they have to find a better defendable position. So she tells them, we've done this three times now. We're down to about 2,000 total warriors, and only about 1,500 of those are battle ready. So after less than a day, they've basically almost been annihilated. So they fight a couple more times, and then they do a flash forward, and there's a lull. There's finally a lull because the sun's gone down, and apparently the ants don't like the cold. So, you know, she finally gets to know Felix a little bit. You know, Felix is still in his warrior mode, like, okay, you know, I'll answer your questions, but I'm not going to, you know, really be a chatty Cathy. He's not going to really, you know, be very friendly. So she explains that, yeah, you know, I was in the Armor Olympics, you know, I got my ass kicked by this great, our best Armor Olympic named Kent, you know, who's, he's basically, when you consider Muhammad Ali to boxing, you know, but they don't make him fight. If he went to he's just doing exhibitions with his armor, but he can do shit like that when no one else can. And she came in second, and she's like, yeah, I wasn't even close. I'm good. He was really good. And she noticed that Felix is really good with the armor. She's like, have you done anything like that before? He's like, no, I just took to it naturally. And she's like, well, the scout suit's basically meant for people with faster reflexes, and you survive longer here because now that no one has any power for, you know, their built-in blaze capacity, then they just have to do everything's hand-to-hand now. So there's no more laser fights, you know, there's no more of that shit. It's all just hand-to-hand brutal combat. It's medieval warfare in space at this point. So everyone's freaking out. There's been very few veterans in this group, so everyone's waiting at this point in the lull to get power at the can, which is basically a big cylinder where you just hook in, you get power up to 100%, and then go on your way. So she goes off to find the commanders because, you know, she knows what she's doing. She's a really good warrior. She's killed a shitload of ants, and she's kind of a symbol now for the warriors. Like, hey, if she can do it, we can do it. And Felix, too, because he fucking survived. So she goes off, and he sits down in line and listens to these three veterans talk about, you know, Bolov, Yin, and Obel. apparently they've had seen a lot of action. They've been doing this for like 8 years. They're like, yeah, we've never seen any shit like this. It's like, yeah, you know, there's a scale that they have where it's like, hey, you have a scale of 1 to 10 on your survivability on any time you drop. And they're all at like, you know, 6 or 7 because they dropped at like, you know, backups for the first three. Then there was no major conflicts that they had to do other than maybe one or two. And it was against different enemies and different aliens. So none of this is even close to what they're doing now, though, is what they say. So they're like, yeah, you know, if you drop as a warrior, you know, you're at a 5 for your first drop. You know, usually you're backup. And Felix tells them, well, yeah, I'm a scout. This is my first drop. They're like, that shouldn't happen. You're supposed to be a veteran before you get to be a scout, and not even your first drop. And I wonder where that puts you on the scale. It's like, for your first drop, and this is a major drop, you're at a 1. He's like, I'm at a 1? He's like, yeah, pretty much. They should have never made you a scout. You should have been backup for like 2 or 3 before you even got here. Yeah, you're fucked. So he's like, all right. And then finally, you know, the other scout, her name is Force, comes back. And she's like, what the hell are you doing waiting here? Scouts get priority. We get to go to the front of the line. He's like, oh, nice. So she's like, what did they tell you? He's like, oh, the rating system. She's like, shit. What they tell you is like, they said I'm a 1. Like, yeah, but that's for, you know, just regular reflexes. You're a lot better than that. So finally, she tells them the plan. Like, hey, we have a plateau. This is where the only place where we can go, where we can defend until our rescue operation gets here in the next, like, 22 hours. Because the ants won't stop coming. And once the sun comes up, they're going to come in force again. So they're like, well, that sucks. That's a horrible plan. I'm like, we have no choice. We have nowhere else to go. We're running out of power. And, you know, we don't have anything left for our blaze capacity. So no more, you know, no more of that. It's all hand-to-hand to conserve power at this point. And they got like 400 wounded. They have mostly another 400 that are just, you know, support. They're not warriors. They're not supposed to fight. So they're basically down to about the last 700 people that can actually fight. The only problem is to get to the plateau, there's 2 steps to get up. So they had to literally throw the people up that are injured and can't move. And so they ask for volunteers, and they volunteer him and Forrest and about 7 other guys to do that while everyone else was waiting at the top, you know, to defend. So the sun comes up. They're still moving people out. And they're like, oh, shit, here come the ants. But it's a narrow steps. So it's not like there's this big old, you know, 2 football yards wide. It's about 10 feet wide. So they're holding them off on the little lips for a long time. So they're doing that. They're trying to they're basically throwing the wounded up now in their armor, trying to get them out of there and save as many as they can. And all of a sudden, you know, there's this big flashing white light and everything goes thermonuclear. Felix wakes up in fucking a tremendous amount of pain, and he finds out later that, yeah, apparently these suits are thermonuclear. They have a nuclear power source, and if you do a certain amount of things, they explode. No one's supposed to know about this, though, because you'd have to do pretty much key everything at once and then eject at the same time. And there's so many commands that are contradictory, it should never happen. But one guy knew, and he was getting carried off by the ants, and he just, like, fuck it, and just, you know, decided to take as many as they could with him. Well, it blew up a shitload of ants, apparently, but the little plateau steps, instead of being like that, now it's just a ramp up. He just basically made them a nice, shiny, you know, handicap ramp all the way up to where they're at now. So the plateau's damn useless. So at this point, they're down to about 200 people total now. So the last person in charge that's still alive tells Felix and Forrest, hey, the only thing we can do is assault this fucking fort that's, you know, sending all these ants at us. And they describe it as a hand. So basically you have, you know, the knuckle right there, and you have the fingers, and then apparently whenever the beacons go off, missiles come out of here and then blow up the whole area. So I know it's a long-winded explanation, but this is the first third of the book. So this, and it's almost at the end, I swear. So they explain, hey, we don't have a choice. We don't have enough people to hold. There's this big-ass ramp coming at us now. We have one, like, emplacement left for a blaze cannon that can go for about 4 or 5 shots continuously, and then it's out. Then the power's gone. And we have another 12 hours here before we could get picked up. So we're going to use what we found out now to say, hey, we'll get a wounded warrior that's about to die. We'll tell him how to go thermonuclear and throw him at the down the fucking hive and have it explode. And maybe that'll buy us enough time so we can survive and get the hell out of here. So Felix is like, well, get someone else to do it. They're like, no, they don't want anyone else. They want you. He's like, why? Because you survived. You survived this the whole destruction of your squad. You survived all the fighting up to now. You're damn good at it. And apparently your buddy Forrest, who's been your only other scout, is terminally, you know, critically injured, and she's about to die. So there's no one else. She was the rallying point. Now it's you. So they get about 4 people and the wounded warrior to try to make this run at the hive. So the plan is, hey, you know, the guy knows what he's doing. He's a veteran. They got another guy that's going to be the squad leader. He'll kind of direct the other 3 guys. He's like, what's his name? Oh, his name is Yin. Like, I met him, you know. So he's like, we have no choice. Either do it or we all die. So he's like, fuck it. All right, I'll do it. So they start, you know, they clear the way with the emplacement. They, you know, a couple ants are there. They all go running towards, you know, up the knuckle, up the palm to the hive to try to find a place right around here where they can have an opening and throw them down. So they're fighting their way up, and then it's like, oh my God, this is going to work. We got about 2 guys left. We got the wounded guy here. And they realize, oh shit, the wounded guy just died. He's got a big ass hole in his face plate. And one of my other guys is wounded. He's, you know, his, he got hit by one of their weapons, and his suit's about to rupture, and it's Yin. So Felix, like, all right, here we go. You're the last one alive. So Felix is fine, but Yin's about to die, and he starts keying his switches to, you know, get ready to explode. He's like, no, get away from me. He's like, you know what you have to do, right? And the guy is like, yeah. And he's like, Felix, you're a filthy fucking human being. And he's like, yep. And just tosses him in and starts running down the fucking knuckle as fast as he can to get away. And then finally, you know, once he hits bottom, you know, he keys all of his relays and ejects, and that finally ends the battle. And Felix wakes up about 10 hours later in the med bay. He's home. He's been rescued. And then he's been learning from the doctors that he's one of the few that survived. There's only about 75 total that survived out of a group of about 10,000 that I originally dropped altogether. So he's like, oh my God, I'm alive. Oh, never doing that shit again. You know, fuck this shit, you know. Like, bad intel, bad preparation, you know, bad commanders. There's no way I'm doing this again. So of all his injuries, you know, the docs are like, oh yeah, you know, you have pretty bad injuries. You got the skin ripped off your shoulders from trying to move around your suit with no power. You know, there's no way you can wear a suit like that. He's like, thank God. And finally, you know, they're treating him. They're giving him some salve. I'm like, why don't they just give me this? It's like, this is shit so you can wear your suit for the next drop. He gets called for the next drop about 48 hours later. His number gets called. He's like, yeah, we need you. Guess what? You're going back down. And he's like, got to do this all over again, and it's not going to get any easier. And he goes back to his suit, and he fucking hates his suit by now. He's like, I hate the thing. And he's like, all right, about to drop again. And he tries to get to that place where he just gets into that zone, you know, and as soon as he comes in and then comes around, he starts crying. And that's how it ends the first third of the book. So this is how they introduce, you know, your character Felix and the war and just this utter stupidity of the war and how bumfuck they were from the very beginning. second, third. Actually, I should take it back. This will be about 40 to 90% of the next part of the book. Follows a different character called Jack Crow. This is 3 years after the original drop and the start of the war, and people are still getting their asses kicked on Banshee. And Jack is a prisoner. So this is how they introduce him. He's in salt mines where basically every 6 hours you take some of the salt, they put it in a funnel for whatever species you are, and you drink it and you have energy for the next 6 hours, which is basically about half as much energy as you would normally have for your species. So apparently Jack's a pirate. He stole some technology that makes you move stars out of the way so you can have like freeways in space to get to certain systems. So he stole it, and then they caught him. He had a trial. He's a big celebrity, and they sent him to these mines to basically serve his sentence. Well, he's like, fuck this shit. I'm getting out today. So he gets his little funnel on his break, you know, where everyone has. He drinks it down, or he pretends to drink it down. Then he sees a guy that got injured in the little alien that got injured earlier in the mines, and goes and basically takes a stalactite and puts it through his fucking head. I'm like, all right, that's the kind of guy he is. So he takes his funnel, which is larger than his, before he's done, and he drinks them both at once, which makes him feel pretty much almost at full strength. And he's like, fuck this, I'm getting out of here. It goes up to one of the bigger guys, the bigger aliens, who's got a huge funnel. So that's going to get him twice his strength if he can get it. So he takes his stalagmite, takes it out of the guy, grabs it by the end, and then just bashes the shit out of this alien, kills him, grabs his funnel, downs the whole thing, feels superhuman, and the guard and everyone else is like, oh, fuck, this guy's going to overdose and then, you know, kill the rest of us for our shit. So he's like, no, fuck that. I heard a ship yesterday land. I'm out of here. I'm getting on that ship no matter what. So he takes a fucking, basically a drill for the mining, and then drills his way out, sees the ship at the starport, which is about, let's say, a mile away, and starts running. And one of the guards, which is about seven and a half feet tall, grabs him, and they have stalks for eyes on top of their heads, and he grabs and just fucking bites into it. The guard lets him go, and he freaking pukes because they got bile for blood, and just runs at the ship like, I'm getting out of here, I'm getting out of here. So finally, you know, he gets to the ship, the gangplank is down from the supplies they're loading on, and he's on there, he's like, oh, it's a fleet ship, you know, these guys have regulations, I'm human, they gotta take me back. And he gets the gangplank, and two guys that are from that are part of the crew, one's a smaller guy, one's a taller guy, they're like, what the fuck do you want? And he's like, and Jack realizes, oh shit, this is a fleet ship, but it's a mutiny ship. These guys don't give a fuck. They don't have a captain. They have mutineers. So he's like, oh, this is a whole different set of rules now. So the tall guy's like, hey, I'm going to call our captain and, you know, our captain and see what he wants to do with him, because he's halfway up the gangplank. They won't let him cut any farther down. And the guards are at the lower end waiting for him to come down, because as big as they are, they know that anything on that ship, they don't know what's on that ship. They think that, okay, we're monsters, but there could be monster eaters on that ship. There could be have anything there that could just kill us. So they're staying at the bottom, not taking the chance. So finally, the little guy is like, you fucking prisoner, you know, with your salt on you little bitch. And then Jack comes up to him and is like, oh, you're just a small little prick. You know, I could kick your ass any day. And he gets pissed off, and the guy attacks Jack, and Jack kicks the shit out of him. You know, kills him, and then the big guy comes down and is like, you motherfucker, and wants to kill him. You know, that was his buddy he just killed. And finally, you know, he kicks him over the side, and Jack's grabbing off for your life because the guy's on the bomb, the guards are waiting for him to drop down. And then finally, you hear this booming voice of the captain go, stop. And everyone does, you know, and he basically takes in the whole situation, goes, points to the guards. And this guy's huge. He's like, he's a human hybrid, I guess you could call. He's about 7.5 feet tall, massive. Just imagine a cartoon character of a professional wrestler in the 80s, and that's how massive he is. And he just points at all the guards and is like, leave. And they do. They all just fucking leave. So Jack's like, all right, I got to spin a story here to, you know, convince him to get me out of here. So he's like, come on, you know, we're getting out of here. And he doesn't realize that the captain knows who he is. He's kind of famous, so the captain's like, so Jack, you want a job? He's like, fuck, you knew who I was the entire time. All right, sure. So apparently, because they're mutineers, they're the only mutineers in the entire fucking fleet. And they're being chased, and they're running out of fuel. So he's like, this is my problem. This is a huge problem. I have a crew here that expects me to solve these problems. I have one solution, and you're going to help me out with it. So there's this one planet where there's this fleet project. It's being sponsored by Fleet, but it's not actually a Fleet planet. Basically, they landed the ship, made it a colony, and then everyone else, you know, that wanted to live there in their little shanty town from all the people that weren't part of Fleet, you know, they made their own place, let's just say, across the river. Like, on one side, they have this Fleet ship that has all these, you know, state-of-the-art, you know, hydroponics, gardening, you know, accessories, and then the other side you have the shanty town where all the colonists live. And they live on their own there. Well, the ship that they dropped had before they converted, it has its own power cell, so that's how they're going to get their fuel. They want Jack to go down and basically con his way in and drop the shield so the ship that they're in can come down, make connection, steal their fuel, and keep running away and get the hell out of there. To somewhere hopefully far enough away that the fleet won't find them. So Jack says, okay, well, what do I get out of it? He's like, you get your own ship, a smaller ship, like a little, this is called a luxury yacht, along with like 10 million credits. He's like, all right, where is it? He's like, fine, we'll show you. So apparently the ship's on the other side of the moon where the planet is, so he, you know, apparently it's just abandoned there. It's one of the many abandoned ships that people used before they dropped down and made the colony for the shanty towns there. So he's like, all right, cool. He was like, what about this suit of armor here? He's like, oh, that we're going to incinerate. He's like, no, give it to me. He's like, why? Well, the guy that runs this place, apparently the reason why there's a Fleet project here, he's trying to find out exactly why the casualties are so high on Banshee. And, you know, as a reader, you know, because they're fucking idiots, but Jack doesn't know because he's just, you know, been in the prison the last couple of years and he has no idea how things are there. He's never been in Fleet. So the captain laughs, you know, his captain's named Borglin. And he's just like, man, anyone that's actually been in the war could have told him that they don't know what the fuck they're doing and all this money and time they spent on this project. And anyway, Jack's like, let me have the suit. You know, it's actually from the war, it looks like. And, you know, the director should like it. You know, it's actually war tech. The guy's a fucking genius, apparently. That's why they gave him the project. He's like 23. You know, Jack's like, you know, 28. So, like, hey, I need something to, you know, get me in with this guy. So they give him a drop pod. They give him the suit. They send him down. And he's like, all right, we have a contact down there. You'll make contact with him. And he'll give you the specs of when we're ready to come down and when you can drop the shield. So he goes down. The very first thing that's happening, and there's almost a riot going on because apparently the colonists don't have food and they want what the Fleet project has. And apparently the genius is out there that the project director is trying to calm everyone down. But he's one of those stereotypical geniuses. Like, just think Sheldon from Big Bang Theory. He's insanely smart, has almost no social skills. So Jack goes in and basically saves them from themselves, talks the rioters down, and then, you know, that's how he's introduced. And it's like, hey, I'm already in. The guy's like, who are you? I'm Jack Crow. He's like, shit, really? You're famous. You know, you're a pirate. This is awesome. You're a famous con man. What are you doing here? He's like, I actually came to see you. He's like, really? The guy's starstruck. You know, he's just one of those guys. It's like if Sheldon met Leonard Nimoy on The Big Bang Theory. That's how starstruck the guy is with him. And he's like, and Jack's just thinking, what a fucking moron. He's like, I brought you something. He's like, what? This suit. He's like, oh. You know. So he basically lets him into the whole project of just you know, his reputation and his gift that he brought up, and he saved his ass on, you know, against the rioters. And Jack's like, how can this happen? This should not. Anyone else had any street smarts would not even let me anywhere near this project. So they let him in. They show him around. You know, Jack gets sick for a couple days because of the local bug. And then they have their formal dinner. They invite him, like, hey, what are you doing here? Like, the project head is not by street smart, but a couple of his underlings that are female, they've been around. They're like, yeah, you're a pirate and a con man. Why are you here? And he basically does his Han Solo and just says, honestly, I can't tell you. And they buy it. They're like, oh, he's got something going on. Oh, yeah, we're in on it. Yeah, we're part of the group. We're the cool kids. And he's just thinking to himself, madness. These guys are fucking morons. So he gets to know, you know, kind of situation there. Apparently, the Borglins guys are oppressing the locals, and the locals don't like it, and they want him to kind of join them because they're in the right. And he's like, fuck that. You guys are calling us with, like, you know, pistols, and Borglins got, you know, blazers and, you know, a whole fucking ship up there, the military ship. I'm not getting in the middle of this. You know, by the way, he's going to be gone anyway. What the fuck do I care? So apparently this planet isn't owned by Fleet. It's owned by this guy named Lewis, who was the first one there. And he's a drunk. He just wants to sit around, drink the synthetic alcohol all day, piss off, and then, you know, have a good time. So Felix meets Lewis when he's slumming in one of the local bars, and this big old fucking guy is trying to hit Lewis, and Lewis is just, you know, kind of going, oh, dodgy here, dodgy there, whoop, you know, as drunk as he is. And the guy was actually apparently a pretty good fighter, but Lewis is just, you know, doing this Jackie Chan drunken style and just kind of avoiding everything, not really attacking back, and just trying to defuse the situation. And he meets Jack, and they get away from this guy, and they go drinking, and you know, and the guy's a hoot. Lewis is an affable soul. You know, he's a pretty cool guy. You know, he's around the same age as Jack, and Jack realizes, Lewis, where have I heard that? Shit, that's a guy that owns a planet? Fuck, man, Borglin did his homework. These guys, that's a guy that's actually the final authority, and he's a drunk, and the Fleet guys have no idea what they're doing because they're, you know, the guy's running that's a super genius and no social skills. It's like, well, that's hilarious. And he thinks, like, that's actually not that funny at all. These guys are going to get fucked. So finally, they come back to the suit. The project head is really enamored with the suit. He's like, oh my god, if I can just get the memories of the suit out, I can get more insight into why there's so many casualties. So apparently the coil that has all the memories on it, like the hard drive, it's degraded, it's corroded, so they can't get anything off of that. So he's like, well, the things that went through on the coil, though, they must have seeped into the suit. So he's like I said, he's a super genius. He's like, all right, if I can take that energy out of the actual suit itself and plug it in my brain, I can actually see everything that he saw and experience what he did in his missions. So he does, and it almost fries his brain. There's so much information. So he's like, well, Jack, you and my number two Holly, how about you plug in with me? That way the feedback won't be as bad, and you can see what I saw. And Jack's like, fuck it, why not? You know, I got nothing else better to do. I've already done my layout. I can take the shields down whenever I want to. You know, I've already told them, hey, just let me know when the shields want to come down. I got time to kill, you know, whatever. So they plug them all basically in these head harnesses, and they go through what turns out to be Felix's very first drop, which is hell on Earth. Or hell on Banshee. So they go, this is Felix's suit they found. And they're like, oh my god, this is what it's like? After they get out, they're like, this is nowhere near what the media's been telling us, or what Fleet's been telling us about how the war's going. And they said that the first drop was a military victory. And they're like, that was some victory. And then they're like, we're never doing that again. That was hell. I can't imagine what it must have been through for the person that did it. But they weren't looking through his eyes per se, but they're experiencing all his emotions and all his terror and all his, you know, and they would know when he was injured, but it's not like they felt everything. So they just experiencing it through his eyes, basically. Like if you're behind someone's eyes and feeling what they're feeling, but not actually getting hurt in the process. So they're like, there's no way we're doing that again. That was horrible, but he survived it. But how do you survive it? You know, it should not have been possible. Like, anyone else would have broken by the first hour. Like, their squad's dead. They're on a planet, lifeless planet, by themselves. There's almost no chance of getting rescued. Anyone else would have broken. He should have broken. Why didn't he? So, they're away from the suit for about a week, but they're like, we have to go back. We have to know why it's happening, and we have to know how he dies, because he has to die eventually. No one can live this way. And they go through another drop, and another drop, and another drop, and they keep dropping Felix. He's been the lone survivor 3 fucking times, including the very first, not including the first one. He was one of the few survivors, but he's been the lone survivor 3 times. He's actually been through the questionnaires out of the lone survivor enough times that he almost has the questions memorized. By the time the third time it happens, and the doctor's like, man, you're getting good at this. You must have gone through this before. And Felix is like, yeah, twice. And he doesn't. He's just like, what? Whatever. You know, he doesn't hear him because no one will believe it. And that shit doesn't happen. And they're like, why do they keep dropping him? This is insane. You know, they can't understand why. You know, the fleet would be doing this to him. It's almost like they're trying to kill him. And they finally figure out from the first battle. Because he was a lone survivor in B Squad, they actually put down in the computer that everyone in B Squad was killed. Like, A and B Squad were dead. And the only survivor is supposed to be from C Squad. So, because his number's still in there, they just keep on calling all the people that are supposed to be dead their numbers for every drop. Because he's still alive, and the computer doesn't know it. They just keep on calling everyone's numbers that ever was in the system, and they just, every time, he reports for duty. And they're like, why isn't he saying anything? Why is he keep on dropping all this time? And they finally, after about 19 missions in, you know, they're in a, you know, they're, and, how do I explain this? Felix is on his 19th mission. You know, they put on their little helmets again, and they're all trash. They're like, how this is killing us. How is it not killing him? We have to know. It's a mystery. They're like, how's this guy surviving? He's like a video game character. But in real life, he's like, this should not be. So they finally say, fuck it. We got to figure out why is this happening. So they have a little powwow before the 19th mission where they're about to put on their... And they say, all right. Here's everything he's going through. Here's his reactions. Here's his emotions. And right now, there's nothing positive about Felix. It's all negative emotions that keep him going. So Jack realizes, oh, it's not. Oh, I need to survive. It's that I must survive, and I'm pissed off at every fucking ant that's on here. He doesn't hate them as a whole. He hates them individually. Like, I fucking hate that ant. I fucking hate that ant. So he gets psyched up every time before his drop. And it's like, he gets scared, then he gets pissed off, and then he gets zoned in. He's a killing machine. And he's been doing it so long now that he's got really fucking good at it, too. So whatever he is on the scale doesn't matter to Felix. He's not a 1. He's not a 10. He's just Felix. He's in a whole other scale on his own. So they're about to drop in for the 19th. Like, it's got to be close. He has to die. It's like a puppy in a well is how they put it. The puppy's injured. You can't do anything for it. You just want to put out some misery, so stop whining. That's how they're likening Felix. And they're starting to hate Felix, too, because he won't die. He won't die. So the 19th drop, him and about 10 other people, the last survivors of the mission, they got about 50 ants just surrounding a beacon. And apparently the beacon's nowhere near the big-ass hive in the first one, so they can actually get home through it, but all the ants are around it. They're waiting for them somehow. They know. So the only way to get through with the 10 guys they have left is, all right, we have these huge badass pieces of armor that are durable and are really fast when you get going, so we're going to basically have everyone come across. Here's the beacon. Everyone come across, five on here, five on here, and then we're going to come at them and have the ants kind of spread out and then come together at the very last moment and just launch ourselves through as many ants as we can to get to the beacon, like missiles. We're going to make ourselves missiles. So he sees that this is the only plan that'll work. They don't have any. They're out of power. This is the only thing that'll work. They're always out of power. No, they never have enough. So the commanding officer is like, you know, sitting there trying to think of any other way around it than to be go into the ants with nothing but your fists. He's like, and Felix knows, like, they won't do it. Everyone's going to pull up at the last second. You know, I'm going to be the only one that's going to go through and actually try to get to the beacon. And I'm going to be swarmed and they're all going to kill me. So Felix got this rookie next to him. He's like, hey, you know, this is a plan, right? This is going to work. He's like, yeah, this is the only way they do it. And you ready? And the guy and the rookie's like, yeah, I'm ready. Yeah, I'll do it. And he's like, yeah, sure, whatever. So they all start running. And Felix is getting up to, you know, he's in a scout suit, so he's a little bit faster than them, but he's trying to time it so they all hit at the same time. And he's like, all right, here's a plan. And now everyone's supposed to ramp up and cut now. And he's going, and he's going. He launches himself, plows through literally like three ants, Superman style. And he's like, he sees the bile in the carapace go past his faceplate, you know, and his faceplate clears, and, you know, and he's fighting and working his way towards the beacon, and he can't get any farther, and he's like, damn it, I knew it, everyone else pulled up, there's no one else here. Now all of a sudden he gets hit in the back really fucking hard, and the rookie's there. The rookie made it through, he put out through everyone, and they're fighting together, and they're crawling towards the beacon, and, you know, he's like, we're gonna make it, and all of a sudden he turns around, and he sees the rookie's freaking disembodied head in front of him, you know, and with nothing else, the ants tore him apart. And for the first time, you know, his badassness, it breaks. He screams and then just throws himself backwards in the beacon with an ant, which is not supposed to happen. So the ant comes through the beacon and starts immediately freaking out. And he's grabbing a hold of Felix and he's, you know, breaking his bones because apparently the ant and the technology that sent him through the transport isn't compatible. And they got this big-ass ant in the drop bay, and all the people are like, oh, shit, there's a fucking ant here. And they're like, kill it somehow. And the ant finally dies, you know, after breaking a shitload of Felix's bones. And Felix is like, never again. I'm done. I'm finally done. No more. And he tells them this finally. He's like, I'm not dropping again. And so they send a counselor down to the med bay. They're like, yeah, you know, you gotta get right back on that horse. So we're gonna send you on a not leave, but a light duty drop. And he's been in pretty much a major battle every single time he's dropped for the last 19. And he's been a lone survivor 3 times, including this one. So we're like, all right. Sure. He's like, hey, can I get his chart? You know, see how many times he's been here. It's like, and the doctor's like, why didn't you have it before? And Felix overhears. He's like, oh, I like to get to know the man first. I don't like to look at the previous charts. And he's like, this guy's a fucking moron. But whatever. You know, so he's resigning. Like, okay, I'll go down for another drop, my 20th. And this is where they kind of know exactly what's going wrong with the whole war from this 20th drop, because he's dropped as a scout, And apparently they're going to drop a fort of their own on Banshee, which is stupid and retarded because Banshee's all sand. So they're, oh no, we found a way out of it. We're going to harden the sand, put walls up, you know, 40 feet high, put big ass cannons on them right in front of the supply drop that Felix was dropped in his first one, their little bunker there that just does nothing but generate ants. So they're there basically to count ants and figure out how long it's going to take them to basically start sending out inferior versions of ants. And he's like, that's it? He's like, yeah, that's it. So he's there as a scout, and his very first thing he does is he finds an ant. You know, he's scouting around, like, hey, I have an ant here. I'm like, okay, keep it there. Can it get to you? No, I'm at the top of a dune. He just keeps on falling down. I'm like, okay, cool. Just keep it there. You know, we're having some other guys meet you, the scientists, you know, we're gonna get a sample from him. Like, all right. So Felix is, you know, the sun's gone down a little bit. It's a little bit cooler. Ants slow down a lot. So Felix surges back on the ant when he gets a radio transmission. And then all of a sudden the ant somehow gets up the dune and tackles him and is about to kill him. But Felix rips a pincher away that's about to rip a hole in his suit. And finally, you know, gets away and gets his blazer and he's about to kill him. And the people I was meeting there, a colonel, like, wait, what are you doing? Stop. No, I thought we told you not to kill the ant. He's like, fine. And he goes away, and the ant's coming towards them now. And the colonel's like, oh, Martinez, kill it. And it fucking blazes its head off, and Felix is just sitting there going, you stop me from killing the fucking ant for that long. I almost died while you're watching this shit happen. And then you just kill it. Internally, he's thinking this, going, all right, you know, same old shit, different day. And, you know, the colonel's like, oh, you know, we just got here. You know, we didn't see it at all. We didn't see you being, you know, fighting with the ant. You know, we would have saved you if that happened. We swear. He's just like, yeah, whatever. So she's like, all right, how do we get out of here? He's like, you're a colonel? And you don't know what you're doing? It's like, oh, no, I'm just from the support staff. They gave me the rank just because the idea for the fort came from my department. And he's like, really? Okay. So they go to the fort. She explains it. Yeah, we're just here to count ants. You know, we got Kent here. It's a PR mission, basically. They have all the high brass there. They all feel safe in the fort. Kent, the darling of the, you know, the military Olympics, is there. He's got his own twice as big suit of armor that, you know, twice as much power, twice as much, you know, strength, because he can use it that way. And Felix is like, this isn't right. This is Banshee. You're not supposed to feel safe. But he does. He even gets out of his armor for the first time on Banshee because they have their own airlocks and all this other shit. And, you know, everyone looks at him as a grunt, though. Like, oh, you know, you're just a grunt. You know, we're the important people. We're the scientists. We're the top brass. You know, we're the ones that really matter. And they look down at him at this little get-together they all have. And another colonel is like, hey, you know, what do you know about Banshee? He's like, this place will fucking kill you, is what I know. It's like, oh, what do you know? It's like, how many drops have you had? One, two? He's like, 20. This is 20. And the guy looks at him dumbfounded, and he just walks away. And the colonel that I was with him before, she comes up to him and was like, yeah, that was a great. Should have seen the look on his face, man. Well, if it were true, though, 20 drops? Fuck. And he's like, so how many have you really had? He's like, yeah, I've had 20. And she's like, what? And this is the first person that's kind of, you know, taking a step back, like, that shouldn't be possible. You know? And he's like, how many have been majors? Like, most? And she's like, that's not possible. That should not be. He's like, and she's like, how can it happen? And she's like, it's Banshee. Like, it's supposed to explain everything. And for the people I fought there, it does. And she doesn't get it because she's a desk jockey. And she's like, no, that's just not possible. Like, you have a commander here that's never dropped before that's in charge of the whole thing. What makes you think it's not possible? And so finally, you know, the day goes by. He gets some sleep for the first time on Banshee without having in a real bed. You know, they go out. they're killing the shit out of the ants at this point. They're coming in waves. You know, they're mowing them down, and finally they get to the point where they're starting to make them shittier. They're like, oh my god, it's working. It's actually working. There's actually hope for winning this war. And Felix feels hope for the first time, but that's not good because Felix realizes, wait a minute, the thing that's been keeping me going, the engine that's been driving me before every drop, I haven't felt it on this drop. And I lost it whenever I screamed the last drop, whenever the rookie I saw him, that broke me. Oh shit, I've been going on nothing but experience and my combat abilities up to this point for this whole drop. The engine hasn't been here, it's just been me. I haven't had anything to hide behind. It's just been me on this drop, and I felt hope. That's not how I survived, but I get a false sense of security here. And he's just freaking out, like, why won't the engine come? What's going on? And he's like, if I feel hope, then I got to remember. If I remember, then I remember her. And it freaking almost kills him remembering some of his past. I'm like, and as a reader, you're going, what the fuck went on with this guy before? That he came here, volunteered, and he has all this negative emotion that keeps him going. So we're like, all right, this is getting interesting. So finally, you know, he goes scouting out to the entrance of this bunker where the ants are coming out of, and the guy that's in charge of the thing, like, I think we can declare victory. They're not coming out for the last 10 hours, and, you know, the last one that were shitty. And he's like, hey, Felix, why don't you go up to the front and see what you can see in? He's like, sure, why not? You know, there's no ants here. Looks like we won. It's like, hey, how about you go inside and see what's in there? And he's like, all right. And he takes a step, and he's like, what the fuck did I just do? And this is a whole PR thing. They had the press there, all the top brass, and he just stops, like, okay, it's been the easiest drop I've ever had. The food was good. The party was fun. No more. And he says, no. And the brass can't believe their mouth. They're like, you're a grunt, and you just told all the full freaking general no. He's like, did I hear you right, Scout? And he's like, yeah. He's like, what if I made that an order? And he's like, make it a fucking request if you want. I'm not going to do it. He's like, Scout, if you don't do it, we'll just send someone else. Like, you send someone else down there to die. This is my 20th drop. How many is this for you, old man? And everyone's like, oh. And they're like, cut the feed. And it's like, you get down that goddamn hole. He's like, no. Fuck off. I've had 20 drops here. This is your first. You send someone else down that hole to make him die. And so after a while, he's like, you sit there. You don't do a damn thing. You don't move. You know, we'll get back to you. So Kent, big-ass Kent, comes out to keep Felix company because Kent knows that as good as he is in the armor, as an Olympian, he's not a killer. He's not a soldier, and he admires Felix because of it. And Felix realizes Kent is a symbol, but that's it. He's not a warrior. He's not a killer. And he explains to Kent, that's how I do it. I don't fight them. I kill them. I hate them. And Kent's like, I don't think I can be that for them. Like, you know what? Be a symbol. You're good at that. So finally, they get back to him on the radio. They're like, hey, since we can't obviously order you to do anything, can we please request you to come, you know, to come back in, you know, with Kent and be debriefed? He's like, fine. So he's like, this is probably the end of my career anyway. I didn't even want to be in this goddamn war. And so, you know, he gets on the radio with the colonel that, you know, he kind of, you know, befriended, and, you know, she knows that he did 20 drops, and she's disbelieving. He's like, oh, you know, don't worry about it. You know, we'll get your back. And shit, what was that? And he's like, what was what? Didn't you feel a tremor? And he's like, no. And then as they're making their way back, she's like, god damn, that was another one. That was an even bigger one. I can't believe he didn't feel that. And Felix realizes, oh shit. And he runs, like, are you inside? He's like, she's like, yeah, I'm inside. Why? He's like, get your ass inside now. He's like, why? God damn. You know, there's nothing to worry about. We're safe here. He's like, think about where you are. Think about what lives here. Think about what lives underground. And And she realizes, oh shit, ants are pouring in through the bottom of the fucking bunker because, yeah, they put walls up, but on the bottom, it's nothing but hardened sand and dirt underneath her. So the ants just went and came up through the bottom, and now they're fucking killing everyone. And Felix and Kent are like, oh shit. So there's another battle that happens. Felix is almost killed again. Kent has an opportunity to save him, and he can't get to him. He's like, oh, you know, should I save you, Felix? You know, he's like, fuck it. He wants to be let off. And before he passes out again, he decides to say, fuck you, hero. He's like, fuck. And then he passes out. They find him later. Felix is still alive. They're giving Kent a medal because they have to. And then Felix is like, I'm good. The engine came back right before then. You know, I'm going to make it. The engine came back with a fucking, after he gave up on life and was like, fuck it. That's when the engine came back. It was like, now that's what you're supposed to do. You're not supposed to have hope. You're supposed to have no hope at all. So all this happens on his 19th drop. And then, you know, the engine comes back and then the drop ends and he's resigned to his fate. I'm probably going to die here. There's no hope, but the engine's back and I'm ready to kick ass again. So after that, they all take their, you know, brain appendages off. And they're like, holy shit. What the hell? It's like, how many more drops did he make? And they're like, there's one more drop on his record. But the thing is, though, when they were looking up Felix's record, they have a message from a planet, which is the richest planet in the entire fucking galaxy, called Golden. They're like, hey, yeah, we're noticed you're looking for this guy. Have you found him? They're like, oh no, we just found his, you know, his suit of armor when he used in the war. Like, why? He's like, yeah, we're looking for our sovereign. We're like, what? So they're like, yeah, if you see him, let us know. They're like, wait a minute. Golden is the most luxurious, most opulent planet, the richest planet, the most advanced planet in the entire fucking galaxy, human-based, and they've lost their sovereign. They look back at the suit like, what the fuck did we stumble onto? So they're like, all right, there's one drop left. We have to know what happened. Like, we have to know that the ants killed him because the ants have to kill him. One of them is going to kill him. So they're like, all right, this is it. This is the last time we have to go in. Let's get it done. So, the last time they go in, they're like, this is it. This is the last drop. It's the last drop on his record. And it's a token drop for the second in command on Golden. It's called the Missal. He wants his own drop. And he pulls Felix's squad to do it for him. So he goes down. They're supposed to set up beacons to try to get, you know, missile sites down there to track because of the shitty sand and interference, there's no way missiles can track from orbit, and that's why they have to send grunts down every time. So they're like, oh yeah, we'll send beacons down and see if we can get missiles to work. So he goes down about an hour in, you know, and the Missal comes up and straight to Felix. And Felix is like, ah, shit. And we're just going, as the readers, we're going, oh crap, we're finally going to find out some of Felix's past. And apparently it comes down to this. Missal is Felix's best friend from Golden. Felix is their guardian sovereign, which is basically, he embodies everything Golden's supposed to be in one person, which is basically their sovereign. Not king, not president. He embodies everything Golden's supposed to be, and he is loved, beloved by the entire planet universally. Everyone loves Felix from this planet. They wanted him. They didn't vote for him, but they all recognize him as this. So now Missal is kind of a secondary, kind of the logistics guy, like lots of power, but still under the guardian. So he goes up to Felix, is like, hey, Felix. And Felix is like, hey, Allie. And he's like, you ran a long way to try to die, didn't you? He's like, yeah, but I don't want to talk about it. And he's like, God damn it, you're not dead. And apparently, Felix loved an Earth woman. Married an Earth woman. Loved her more than anything in life itself. And his planet didn't. It was kind of like, eh. You know, just think of a monarch in England, like Prince Henry married someone that the public wasn't too keen about. That's how the planet felt about his wife. So his wife decided, hey, I'm holding you back. You know, I'm going off to another planet. And when she gave him that message, her freighter had an accident and she died. And he couldn't take it. So, you know, the Messiah was trying to say, you can't blame a whole planet for that. He's like, it wasn't all about that. You know how long it took me to lose my freaking bodyguards? It took me 3 months of planning. She lost hers in 5 minutes. That's a lack of commitment. The planet didn't love her. The planet let her die, basically what it comes down to. Like, she lost him in 5 minutes. They didn't care. Then she died because of it. Fuck Golden. So Ally's like, yes, but you can't die. You're still alive. He's like, God damn it, I want to die. Ally says, you can't, though, can you? Because you're Felix, and you must be killed. And that kind of tells you all you need to know about why Felix has still survived. It's like, he wants to die, but he can't. So he goes to a shitty war, volunteers to Earth, knows he's going to die, knows they're fucked, but has this will to survive because that's how he was brought up and that's the kind of person he is. And he explains that, you know, finally, you know, Ally gets through to him. The Messiah's like, hey, you can't even say her name, you know, of his wife. And he finally breaks down, passes out, and Felix kind of comes back to his senses and like, you know what, it's all good. You know, the engine was dying anyway. It hadn't been coming as often. And Ally's like, what the hell is that? It's like, pretty much my survival instinct. It's what's been keeping me alive. So Felix is finally resolved to live, you know, but he's not going back to Golden. Ally got him his own special ship. And he's like, hey, you know, I got you some money in the ship. And you can use it to do what you want, but, you know, you can't run away from me anymore. He's like, fine. You know, that's a good compromise. You know, I missed you. You're my best friend. You know, we had grew up together. And finally, all right, let's get the fuck out of here. Because, you know, even though they're in a spot on Banshee where there shouldn't be any ants, Felix is like, yeah, you don't really been keeping up at how fucked up they are here, right? They have no idea what's going on. So, like, hey, the beacon's there. Let's get out of here. They're about 5 minutes away. And, you know, the sandstorm that's going on, they're finally clear. And he's like, oh, there's a beacon. Let's get out of here. And then one of the bodyguards is like, man, I'll be glad to get out of here. What the fuck is that, a mountain? Yeah, it kind of looks like a hand. And Felix is like, hand, mountain? Oh, God, the knuckle, the hammer is coming down. The missiles. Fuck, no, the beacon's right there. Shit. And then he just looks at his friend and he starts screaming, get back. And then the hammer comes down. And it just obliterates everything in the area. And his best friend dies in his arms. He gets to the beacon. Felix is a lone survivor again. For the fourth time. And his best friend is dead. And he's done. He's broken. Banshee couldn't break him. The ants couldn't break him. This finally broke him. He's just in a daze. He's in his armor. You know, he's getting led away. Because this is a fucking big-ass dignitary that just died on Banshee, and everyone is freaking out once they get back. And he's just being led away. He's kind of dazed, and he's like, oh, what? And he realizes it's Kent that's leading him somewhere. And he's got a look in his eyes like he's resolved. And he's like, oh, shit, no. I want to live now. And all of a sudden, you see a fist come at his face, and it just blanks out. And that's the end of it. That's all you see. And then everyone takes their helmets off and they say, oh my God, the ants didn't get him. Fucking Kent got him? our symbol, our hero, everyone's hero, can't kill them? That can't be the end. The ants were supposed to kill him. They were supposed to kill him. They had to kill him. They needed it to be by the ants. And they're like, that's it. We have no more information. And they're all wiped out. So they go and they sleep for like 3 days. Jack Crow, who you remember, is now like, he gets a message like, hey, bring down the shields. You know, we're coming the next couple days. So he does that. He passes out. And he gets woken up by an assistant and said, hey, the city is burning. You know, something's happening. And he's like, oh, shit, Borglin's here. Fuck. I'm kind of having second thoughts now. After seeing all this guy went through, this may not be the most righteous thing to do for the money and for my own ship anymore. So he's got kind of attached to this now. He's like, yeah, too late now. So he goes out. And the rebels that don't like Borglin's guys, they're getting their asses kicked. Because they have basically rifles that are, you know, bullets, and they are getting, and Borglin's guys have military equipment, mortars, blazers, grenades, and armor. So they're getting shredded. And Jack's like, fuck, you know, this sucks. And he finally realizes that after talking to the rebels that Borglin isn't coming there to steal the fuel. He's coming there to stay. And he's like, what? He's like, yeah, you really didn't know? He's coming here to stay. And he's like, it makes sense. The planet's owned by Lewis, the drunk guy. It's a fleet project, but they're leasing the land on there, so it's not a fleet planet. They have no jurisdiction. If Borglin goes down, takes over the fucking settlement, fleet has no say there. It's an independent planet. So he can rule with an iron fist. And, you know, he realizes it, a mortar lands near him, and he gets knocked out. And Jack comes to, like, 12 hours later, and his buddy, the project director that he's just gone through all this shit with, you know, with Felix with for the last, like, month, you know, who's a really good friend, he's in his little complex that, it's still a ship, even though that the shields are down. They still have power, and they still have, you know, a couple of, you know, shipboard weapons they can use to defend themselves, along with some munitions. But it's a science vessel. So he's got maybe one little dinky cannon and some munitions, but no one there is a trained military personnel. They're all support staff and scientists. So Borglin's talking to him on the radio, and he's like, Director Ware, Hollis Ware, you can surrender now, or you can make it difficult for yourself. And he's like, yeah, I know. He's like, you know what happened, right? You know how I was taken down? You know you're betrayed from within? He's like, I have a pretty good idea, yeah. So Jack's like, oh, fuck. You're one man against basically 100 mutineers that have no option but to stay on this planet, otherwise they're gonna die. So Jack makes his way over there, gets in, confronts his buddy, the director, and was like, there's no way you can win. There's nothing you can do. He's like, I have to, though. I have to stay. I have to fight. He's like, why? Why do you have to fight? He's like, did you see the city? Did you see how brutal it was just to get here? Think how brutal he's going to have to be when he takes over. I have to take out as many of these guys as possible so future generations, when they finally do overthrow him, it can be a little bit easier. Because right now, he's going to win, but I got to make him use up as much of his munitions and energy as possible and make it expensive for him. And he's like, fuck it, I'm in. Why not? I feel like shit anyway for doing this. I'll die with you. Fuck it. So they got a little, you know, they're set up pretty well. They got a couple grenades. They got some blaze rifles. They got a little turret on top of the ship that's got like a little dinky turret that can shoot. So they get a couple of them. They make a run. They make a pretty good showing themselves, but they're getting their asses kicked. And they go to the entrance and like, fuck it, we're getting overrun. You know, like they get injured a little bit. They drag back and close the hatch again, and they're back in their little room. And they're like, how the hell did we get back here? And they see Lewis there, and Lewis is like, what the fuck are y'all doing? And it's like, Lewis, this is your planet. Don't you want to fight for it? He's like, no. Why would I want to? And he's like, and why would you want to? I thought you didn't care. He's like, because there's no one else. And Lewis is like, that's it? That's the only reason there's no one else? And he's like, well, yeah. You know, Jack Crow and director look at each other like, yeah, there's no other option. And Lewis is just like, there's really no other option, is there? And they're like, why do you care? No. And he's like, okay. He has this resigned look on his face and like, what the hell's this drunk gonna do? Yeah, he's pretty limber, but you know, this is an army out there. And they're like, yeah, I was afraid you'd say that. And he starts stripping off his clothes and they're like, what the fuck are you doing? And then the director's like, he realizes it before Jack does, and he starts crying. He's like, oh, God. Oh, God. And Lewis goes over to the suit, palms it open, and the thing fucking opens for him. And it's like, oh, shit, it's Felix. And the first thing Jack says is, I don't know how the fuck you aren't dead. He's like, you got a couple minutes? You know, mentioning to the army outside. He's like, yeah, I guess. Like, we saw Ken kill you. He's like, oh, no, Kent didn't kill me. He just popped my suit open. He was afraid I was going to resist. It's like, God damn, that man was strong, though. So he popped my suit open, and he put me on Allie's pleasure yacht with all my allowance on there. And I got here, and that was the first one here when they found him. Like, oh, shit, that was supposed to be Jack's reward. That's why the suit was in there. The yacht with all the money on it was supposed to be for Felix to get out of there and go do his own thing. And then Felix got to the planet. So whenever the fleet got there, he was still the first one there. He was, you know, the first founder. So he's in his suit and they're like, are you okay? He's like, yeah, I'm out of shape a little bit. It kind of hurts. And they know what it's doing to him to be back in that suit after everything he went through in it. And they're like, well, where are you going? I'm like, I'll be back. He's like, Felix. He's like, yeah, nothing. Later. He's like, yeah, later. And he goes out, and the director's like, fuck, I want to see this shit, because they know what Felix is capable of. He gets a monitor working, and Felix is just everywhere among these guys, killing, you know, leaping across whole rivers, you know, just destroying Borglund's forces. And Borglund's on the line going, fuck, get us out of here, get us out of here. He's like, oh, fuck it. You know, it's just one guy in power, and he kills his second in command. I was like, you said he never got across a fucking river. He's like, get us out of here now. So he's lifting off, you know, and they see, the last thing they see is Felix clamped onto a freaking stanchion, climbing up the goddamn ship, sees the camera, smashes it, you know, and then cranks open the hatch and then closes behind him, and just, that's it. That's the last they see of Felix. You know, after that, the project breaks away from Fleet because the Fleet's a piece of shit. They don't care. A couple years later, you know, some people from Golden came by looking for Felix. Like, the ship had no fuel. It's like, it's got to be out there somewhere, but it's dead. Everyone on there's got to be dead by now. They're like, you didn't see him die, though, did you? They're like, no, then we're going to keep looking. So the book ends with this quote from the Missal to Felix that pretty much sums up the entire thing. When they're on the Banshee before Missal died, there's this quote that is the Missal says, you are what you do when it counts. And that pretty much sums up the entire book. It's like, you can be whatever you want to be. You can be a piece of shit. You can be someone looking to die. But when it counts, what are you going to be whenever it really does count, when people are counting on you? And this is why it's my favorite book. And this is almost an hour and a half long, but it ends with Jack looking up to this guy and going, are you there? Are you still out there, Felix, fighting the good fight? Because he is the toughest son of a bitch that in the universe. And that's how it's going to end. This is my first video. I hope you enjoyed my review of John Stakeley's armor. He was working on a sequel. Unfortunately, he passed away before he got past the little prologue. But this is random stuff I like. It's my new channel. It's a long one. The other ones will probably be a little bit shorter, but I'll catch y'all later.